into cybersecurity? There's a ton of content out there, and if you don't know where to start, it can be overwhelming, even paralyzing. So let's fix that. Welcome to Simply Cyber, a community of tens of thousands of aspiring and active cybersecurity professionals focused on networking, knowledge sharing, and professional development. I'm Dr. Gerald, Auger, Chief Content Creator at Simply Cyber, inviting you to get the answers to your cybersecurity problems with hundreds of cybersecurity videos answering your frequently asked questions, interviewing industry experts, and live streaming daily cyber threat briefings hosted by me. Now get the stories and insights you won't find anywhere else. Hit subscribe now and dig into all the fresh content on the channel and in the community. Nothing should stop you from launching and leveling up your cybersecurity career today. All right. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the show. Today is Wednesday, Worldwide Wednesday, Hump Day, November 29th, 2023. Welcome to episode number 504 of Simply Cyber's Daily Cyber Threat Briefing. I am your host, Dr. Gerald Auger, and over the next 45 minutes, me, you, Kenneth Ruff, across the pond, Tom Bishop from the boot, Cherise Lamb, Natalie Garrett, Dream Logic Inc., Frank Andreuli down on the East Coast, Mr. Green Reed's in the house with the coffee cups, Glory, Chris Young, Paul Savage, Git K, Rogue 2022, Paul Savage, so many of you coming over, Marcus Schuyler recognizing the double yeet, LinkedIn, YouTube, first-timers and long-timers, and I'm going to give the first-timers a lot of love today because I missed a lot of first-timers yesterday. We're all going to be shredding the top cybersecurity news stories of the day, and I'll be giving my expert opinion and analysis on each of those stories, on what it means to you as a practitioner, so how can you take this information and operationalize it, whether it's for cyber risk reduction from an engineering capacity, whether it's a strategic implementation of long-term threat landscape shifts, or maybe it's to be implemented for information security awareness so you can keep your end users safe from themselves. Either way, we're going to be diving into it. I do not research or prepare for any of the stories. In fact, I don't even know what stories are going to come up. So you're going to be getting my rough, rugged, and raw first impressions and analysis of these stories, just like you're going to be getting them for the first time as well. Also, don't sleep if you think that you're trying to break in the industry and this show isn't for you. We are an inclusive bunch here at Simply Cyber. You will be asked in any single cybersecurity job interview, how do you stay current on the industry? Believe me when I tell you that saying the Simply Cyber Daily Cyber Threat Briefing is a great way to start the answer to that question, but then having intel, backup, citing case study from the cyber threat brief is going to chef's kiss that interview for you. On top of that, first timers and people breaking in, you see all these wonderful people like James Zutacudo, Alfredo, Austin Carter, Leon Elliott, Chris Young, all these people, they're here every day showing up, helping each other, supporting. Sandor knows with the Oprah emote. Throw out your Oprah emotes, if you will. We are a supportive, inclusive bunch. So get in here, make the circle wider. There's room for everybody, and you will benefit, I promise you, if you stick around. Now, before we get into the goodness, let me take a hot minute and say shout out and thanks to the stream sponsors. Those businesses that I affiliate with, respect and appreciate for them enabling me to be able to go full time and deliver this news briefing every single morning to you. Starting with my good friend Eric Taylor over at Barricade Cyber Solutions. Oh yeah, look at Oprah just flowing through the streams. Hey Oprah. Hey girl, hey. Barricade Cyber Solutions is dedicated to helping businesses from cyber attacks and recover from the damage done. Cyber attacks can cause massive issues for business owners and send dedicated, hardworking business owners into turmoil. Talking upset tummy. Oh my God, did I eat tacos last night with extra ghost peppers? No, you're actively being attacked by a ransomware incident. Oh geez, the experience is the same. But don't worry, Barricade Cyber Solutions knows how to mitigate the damage done by cyber incidents. Believe that. Check them out at barricadecyber.com. Links in the description below. Also want to say shout out and love to my man, Brandon Poole, and his team over at Panoptcy. Panoptcy Security. Whoops. Eric Taylor coming in hot.
Best friends.
Yep.
Eric Taylor. It's completely unrelated that I'm taking a layer off and that Eric Taylor just dropped a 50 spot. This isn't a strip tease. No, Eric Taylor, you're not dropping another 50 and I'm taking my shirt off. That's not happening. Listen, guys, shout out to Eric Taylor and Barricade Cyber. Not only are they a stream sponsor, but they are just sponsored 150 members of the squad.
Best friends.
Yep.
Let's go. Let's go. Dude, hey, 150 of you folks who just are warming up. There's 230 of you. 150 of you are now minted Simply Cyber squad members. If you want to know how to become a squad member using the gifted sub, you do have to opt into it. I think if you do exclamation point squad or exclamation point something, There's a link that you can click that will pop up and show you how you can enable it. Just mods, if you can help out. If anyone has a question on how to receive the gift that Eric Taylor just dropped, let's do it. But good morning. We're off to a great start already. Now, guys, listen, Panoptcy Security, get a partner who understands your cyber program and your business goals. Guys, whether you are a one-man shop, a one-woman shop, or you've got a whole team under you, but you need a little bit of help on strategic direction, on focus, on taking a framework like NIST CSF and implementing it in a practical way, Panoptcy Security can help you. They also do tabletop exercise. Holler! So what's going on? Panoptcy.com, go check them out. If you need cybersecurity assistance and help, they absolutely can do that. Believe me. Great company. Wonderful people, and they know exactly what they're doing. Left of Boom is where they operate. Check it out. Exclamation point gift in chat will tell you exactly how to do it. Thank you, priority problem solvers. Guys, it is Worldwide Wednesday, so we're going to do that in a hot minute. I want to say shout out to Antisyphon Training. More about them at the mid-roll. But do me a favor, guys. Every single day has a different theme. Some people like the community member of the week on Monday. Some people like Tidbits Tuesday. Some people do not like Tidbits Tuesday. I was called the lazy eater yesterday for my disdain for seeded fruits. But that's okay. We're all entitled to our opinions. Justin Gold, that blue badging in 20 months looks good on you. All right, guys. Hey, Worldwide Wednesday. We've got a really special one today. But first, let me tell you, each episode of the Daily Cyber Threat Briefing is worth one half a CPE. So it stacks up 2.5 a week, 10 a month. Be sure to, be sure to say what's up in chat. Take a screen cap, file it off. And when it's time to do your CPEs, just count up the number of screen caps you have, multiply it by 0.5, and you're off and running. I forgot ACI Learning sponsors Worldwide Wednesday, so let me go ahead and pin that. All right, guys, my favorite activity. A lot of people have told me that Wednesday is their favorite day of the week for the Simply Cyber Daily Cyber Threat Briefing because of the Worldwide Wednesday. So let's get into that. And people are going to love it. If you're new here, well, hold on. I'm screwing all this up. Guys, if you're a regular hashtag team live, if you're here live, if you're in comments, hashtag team replay, love you all in replay. I see your comments. I engage with you all. Obviously, Team Live, 281 of you beautiful souls here today. Many of you freshly minted squad members because of the wonderful gifts from Barricade Cyber and Eric Taylor. Guys, let me tell you, if today is your first time on the stream, if this is your first episode, whether a friend told you, you stumbled on it, however you ended up here, there's a seat for you right there. Please sit down. You're more than welcome to stick around. But if it is your first time, do me a favor. Drop hashtag first timer in chat. We love welcoming our first timers. We have a special emote for our first timers. We have a special sound effect for our first timers. And it is all about good times in here. So let me take a slug of my coffee. And if you're a first timer, this is the sounder you're going
to
get.
Welcome to the party, pal.
Oh, it's so good, this coffee. Let me pour a cup of coffee and tell you what's about to happen. I'm going to play some music. I'm going to pull up a global map. I'm going to ask you where you're at, and we are going to see if in 2 minutes we can go around the world because that's how awesome, listen, that's how awesome the Simply Cyber community is. All of you are amazing, and we aren't just US-based or North American or native English speakers. We are worldwide. We are we are a melting pot, y'all. I love it. And really quick, I see the first-timers coming in. Tim Maddock. What's up, Tim Maddock? Our Calypso Youngblood. I love it. I love it. I love it. What's going on, y'all? Welcome, first timers. I hope you guys enjoy it. Let's rock and roll. We got someone over on LinkedIn who showed up as anonymous. Welcome to the party, pal. You know what? Anonymity is acceptable here. Welcome to the party, pal, if you're over on LinkedIn. Love it. Love it. Love it. Okay, guys, do me a favor. Mods, get ready. Sit back and let's get ready to go around the world. I'm going to play a different song than Daft Punk, though. Here we go. All right, guys. Let me just tell you really quickly. Worldwide Wednesday is presented by Worldwide. Hold on, my God. Worldwide Wednesday is presented by IT Pro TV, now IT Pro from ACI Learning, the international online training solution that professionals in audit, cyber, and IT turn to for binge-worthy content. If you know, you know. Use my code SimplyCyber30 to get instantly 30% off your first month or first year at ACI Learning. Links in the description below. I'll drop a quick link. I've got a pinned comment there. Remember, SimplyCyber30 is the code. Thank you very much for sponsoring it. All right, guys, let's rock and roll. Where are you at? We've got 1 minute, 48 seconds. Let's go. Where are you at? Las Vegas, Nevada. CJ is online. Hey, CJ, love it. Our Calypso's in Massachusetts. Love it. What's up, Timothy Ott in the great state of Texas? Chi-Town, Toronto's online. Bring it. UK, Kenneth Ruff, bringing it online. I love it. Europe is here. Welcome, Europe. All right, let's keep going. Baltimore, Maryland. Japan, Fernando. Love it, love it, love it. Bringing Asia online. Afghanistan. Abdullah loves the show. Thanks, Abdullah, for bringing Afghanistan on. Let's go. We got Middle East, Uganda. What's up? We've got Uganda online. All right, I'll get back to Uganda. I need an assist on Uganda. New Jersey is a different country. I love it. Philly's in the house. What's up, Philly? Hey, Charlotte. What's up, Colombia? We're going to take Colombia. We got South America online. Let's rock, baby. India. Yes, India. Love it, love it, love it. Brooklyn. Brooklyn in the house. Turkey. Love it, love it, love it. Let's go. OKC. My man. What's up, Massachusetts? Love it, love it, love it. Hey, Florida. Flo Ride is in the house. What's going on? We got Ghana, baby. Ghana's in the house. Oh, Ghana. I need an assist, man. My African geography is awful right now. We got Ghana and Uganda. Sicily, Italy. We got the boot online. Love it. Nigeria. Now that one I got. Boom. Africa's online officially. What's up, Minnesota? It is cold there. Hey, Nola. Very cool. Poland Central is bringing it online. Europe is hot. All right, guys. That was a quick 2 minutes. Jesus. Let's just roll that back. All right, we are priority problem solvers with a squad membership. I'm just gonna play the music. We are rounding out, but we're just capturing it here. Here we go. Singapore. Jesse, that doesn't help. I need like a arrow pointed to it. We've got so many coming in hot. South Carolina, Ghana's in West Africa. Thank you. Yes, Ghana's here. Where's Uganda? I need help with Uganda. We got Singapore. Singapore is not Cambodia. South Korea. Where is Singapore? I feel like Singapore's like, oh my God, I need an assist, bro. Bangladesh is in Singapore. Papua New Guinea's not Singapore. Did we get Australia? Tanzania? Oh. All right. Dude, we're going to have to figure out a better workflow. Honestly, because... Oh, Singapore. Singapore's so tiny. Holy Jesus. All right, where's Uganda? We got to figure out Uganda here. The DR is in here. Double check above. I don't see it. Where's Uganda? Oh, Uganda's like right in the middle. All right, I got you, Uganda. All right, guys, we have Kenya. All right, I'm going to have to put a pause on this. Guys, Israel's in the house. Way to go, Israel. Good to see you. Philippines is in the house. All right, we're going to do an extended cut. I love it. Cameroon's here. I'm going to get a map of Africa and like and study it here. Cameroon, we got strong Western Africa representation. Angola. Damn. Boom. Dude, you guys are amazing. I love it. I love it. I love it. Hey, I want to thank all of you. Poland, France, the DR's in here. I think that's probably Leonardo. He's always representing the DR. Let's see if we went around the world. Okay, so survey says we did not. Did we not get Australia? Did we not get Australia, y'all? Oh, there's Kenya. I love it. Dude, first of all, a couple things. One, apologies. Like, sometimes I'm right on top of these countries, and sometimes I'm like a blind man in a brothel, just kind of feeling my way around. Whoops. Sorry, Kennedy. South Africa's in the house. All right, so we're going to say we did not do it. Did we not get Australia? Did we not get New Zealand? Did we not get... Oh, my God. All right. Hey, we're like, guys, I'm going to let you know right now, me and the mod team, we're going to work on finding a better way to do this map thing. We've done it for over a year. It's a wonderful experience. I love seeing where all of you are right now. It's very much. Oh, my God. No Australia. Okay. All right. So. I want to say thank you, all of you, very much. That was a lot of fun. The mods are getting restless right now. The mods are getting restless. They are upset that I'm stumbling and bumbling over here with Worldwide Wednesday. But believe me, it is worth it. Okay. All right, guys. Be well. Thank you. Thank you for Worldwide Wednesday. We can all collectively pile on Australia for not showing up. Just kidding. We do love our Aussies. Plus, it's like, it's the middle of the night there. So that's what's up. All right, guys, do me a favor. Sit back, relax, and let's let the cool sounds of the hot news wash over us in an awesome wave. I will see you guys at the mid-roll.
From the CISO series, it's cybersecurity headlines.
These are the cybersecurity headlines for Wednesday, November 29th, 2023. I'm Sean Kelly. Ransomware gang busted in Ukraine by international operation. European authorities said Tuesday that Ukrainian police arrested the 32-year-old ringleader of a ransomware operation along with four accomplices as part of an international investigation. The gang's attacks impacted victims in 71 countries using ransomware variants including Locker Goga, Megacortex, Hive, and Dharma. The arrests are the continuation of an investigation that began back in 2019 and included 12 arrests in 2021. Seven countries took part in the investigation, including personnel from the U.S. Secret Service and the FBI.
Okay, couple things here, all right? First of all, here we go. All right, so we got a win for law enforcement. If you guys know, things that I get out of bed for are really, really good infographics and coordinated law enforcement takedowns of threat actor groups, okay? Like, that's my jam. All right, so ransomware gang broken up. I want to point out, just because, like, you know, at least the United States and on the global stage, Russia invaded Ukraine. Many people are like, Ukraine is, you know, victimized or whatever. That doesn't mean that, like, everybody in Ukraine, is a good person now, right? Like, there are criminals. Before Russia invaded Ukraine, there was Ukrainian-based threat actor groups, Conti, which was a notoriously effective and large tier one ransomware threat actor gang. Half of that gang was out of Ukraine, okay? I believe Revil, which was another massive threat actor group in the space, was out of Ukraine. So there is still activity, despite the global conflict, of threat actors operating out of Ukraine. And I also want to point out, like, dude, I haven't been to Ukraine, obviously, and I don't know. But my thoughts are, if there is like war-torn stuff, maybe like getting jobs, maybe paying, you know, feeding your kids, putting a roof over your head, maybe these things are a little bit more difficult. And some people are turning to a life of crime, especially considering how lucrative It is. So I'm not passing judgment. There's a lot of moral and ethical questions to ask oneself before making decisions. But I love that the police are moving forward and doing these things and basically helping individuals and businesses, right? Like at the end of the day, it sucks that maybe these people are doing it for a life of crime or because they feel that they don't have any other options and they need to. But let's not lose sight of the victims, right? If you're a manufacturing company in upstate South Carolina and this threat actor group takes you down, well, all the people who work there might lose their job. The people who own the business might lose that. The people who depend on the product coming off the manufacturing line to support their business operations might go under. So there is a trickle effect or a ripple effect that could disrupt and cause real catastrophic pain for victims who didn't do anything wrong. So I'm loving this. Secondly, immediately looking at this, there's no question in my mind that this is not a police officer working at his desk. This is very much a police officer, a live screenshot of him capturing evidence from a criminal's desk. Why do I say that? You tell me, is it Ukrainian? This is like a 60-inch widescreen TV. Why is my feed all jacked up right now? Hold on, we've got some issues. How's the feed? Can you hear me? We have issues. We have issues. Hold on one second. Is my audio good? My feed bad? All right, hold on. Let me see. Hold on. Let me see what you guys see, because right now what I'm seeing is not good. What I'm seeing is broken. Let's do this. All right, can you hear me? Can you hear me? Let's do this.
Catch me outside, how about that?
All right, let me do this. You get to see me make the sausage, okay? Oh, of course. Dude, why? Oh my God, you are ridiculous. You're ridiculous. Come on. You know what I don't have time for? I don't have time for like technical malfunctions. Let's keep rolling here. All right, hold on. I'm going to get this sorted out. And by the way, just for those who are like content creators and audio cinephiles, I'm streaming at 720p right now, not 820, and that is super annoying. Give me a hot second. I rebooted my computer too this morning. Streamlabs OBS or Streamlabs desktop, you're on the cutting block right now, brah. All right, hold on one second. This is me literally making the sausage while we go. Hold on one second. Here, do me a favor. Let me give you a topic. Grape nuts. Grape nut cereal. Not a grape or a nut. Discuss amongst yourselves. Give me a second. Oh, I love that Streamlabs crash handler's running. That's convenient. I've got to end like 95 services right now. No, I don't want that. Hold on. This is me annoyed right now. Ugh. Okay. Here we go. Let's go. One second. All right, here we go. Stand by to stand by. All right. Look at me go. Look at me go. I'm live, baby. All right. Hey, you know what? Here's what I gotta say. Streamlabs OBS, you don't see me. You don't see me. I own you. I can kill tasks like a boss and restart things. All right, let's keep going here. TLDR, that 50-inch, 60-inch monitor, that's either, you want to talk about discretionary spending at law enforcement, a 60-inch widescreen, more likely that's a cyber threat actor's desktop and they're collecting evidence. TLDR, law enforcement, they're going to get you. You hear footsteps, threat actors, that's law enforcement coming for you. Let's go.
North Texas Water Utility hit with cyber attack. The North Texas Municipal Water District, which serves 2 million people in North Texas, is dealing with a cybersecurity incident. On Monday, the cybercrime gang known as Dex and Team claimed to have stolen more than 33,000 customer information files belonging to the utility. A spokesperson said that most of the water utility's network has been restored, but that phone systems are still offline. NTMWD's Core Water, Wastewater, and Solid Waste Services were not affected by the incident. The incident comes just one day after a cyber attack on a Pennsylvania water authority forced workers to use backup tools to maintain water pressure.
All right, everything's done bigger in Texas, so... You know, this municipality has 850 employees, I guess. Dude, I don't know if this is a coincidence or if there's like a threat actor who's like almost like a Batman villain, like Mr. Freeze or the Riddler, except it's like the water ransomware threat actor. There's been kind of a little rash of ransomware threat actors targeting water municipalities. I spent a lot of time yesterday. Someone get Justin Gold on the phone. And let's let Justin know about this. Literally, Justin Gold's budget requests are being written for him real time here. Guys, a lot of times water municipalities are not well-funded. They don't have lots of staff. People just kind of, like, water just happens, right? In the United States, water just happens. Again, this is a very... my view, my perspective, I guess let's go ahead and do a tinfoil hat so I don't, get everybody super mad at me, but everybody just kind of accepts water just happens. You don't really think like, oh, like, you know, like where's this water come from or where's the water get clean? Like I flush the toilet, the water takes the waste away and I'm thumbs up. I open the tap, take a sip of water and move about my day. I don't think about it. But it really is a critical utility and it requires operational technology and information technology and staff to do it. Now, this water utility company, just to let people's minds rest at ease in whether this is legacy tech or by design, probably legacy tech, the IT systems were hit, not the OT system. So people in North Texas are able to drink water and flush the toilets and that's what's up. Oh, Toasty Pops. Toasty Pops talking about a flood of ransomware. Very funny. Basically, if you work in water utility, wastewater management, there's, you know, a million things that you can do. Let's see if they talk about how, because with ransomware and the utilities, like, it sucks, it's fine. But the real question to me is, how did they initially get in? And can we put in something to... prevent that from happening. So let me just quickly skim this article. Again, I don't read these or review in advance. Standard practice, right? They got hit. They contact a third-party forensic specialist like BarricadeCyber.com. That's a pretty standard practice. Come on, man. How did they get hit? They stole 33,000 files. Okay. Here's the thing, right? Like if my local water municipality had my PII stolen or whatever, I'd be like, all right, like it sucks, but it's already out there. Now, if you impact my ability to get water, like it's Flint, Michigan or something, then we've got a problem. And, shout out to Flint. Sorry again. I don't know if it's too soon to even talk about that, but, you can see here in the story, they say, here's the challenges, which I just laid out. Limited budget, limited staff, third-party dependencies, direct vector for widespread impact on life, safety, and health. 100%. This right here, this should be copy and pasted and be the opening slap you in the face slide on the budget request for the water municipality people. Like, we are getting screwed, people. It doesn't say in the story how they got impacted. If I had to guess... poor basic cyber hygiene of end users, misconfigured servers, open RDP, crappy credentials that get guessed, whatever. It's not good.
Former Uber CISO speaks out after 6-year silence. Back in May, former Uber CISO Joseph Sullivan was sentenced to 3 years probation, 200 hours of community service, and $50,000 fine for failing to report the infamous breach that affected over 50 million Uber customer and driver records. Sullivan's lawyers advised him to remain silent despite what Sullivan claims were false accusations by the media that he covered up the breach. With the matter now settled, Sullivan is speaking out after 6 years of silence. Sullivan said people don't realize that he and his team followed their internal incident playbook, engaging legal counsel, public relations, and Uber CEO. Sullivan does admit that he made the mistake of not engaging third-party investigators and counsel to validate their internal handling of the incident. Sullivan plans to share his story in a keynote address at Black Hat Europe 2023 on December 7th.
Ooh! All right, yo, if you got to go to Black Hat, I usually don't go to the keynotes at Black Hat because it's like going to like a Taylor Swift concert. There's like 50,000 people and it's a hot mess express. And as much as I love the Simply Cyber community, I do have this weird neurotic thing where I don't really like crowds. Like when you're getting like crushed in by crowds and I can't move as quickly as I want to, I don't like that. It makes me uncomfortable. By the way, double-edged sword shout out to like Christmas in the United States. Dude, if you go tidbits Tuesday on Wednesday, if you go to Costco at any time other than Monday between 6 and 7 p.m., it is a nightmare. It's a Tim Burton movie in real life. Holy crap. It's like going to Bucky's. Welcome to Bucky's. Welcome to Costco. It's like, oh my God, bro. Sorry. That was a bit of a departure. Fancy. The Uber CISO, Joseph Sullivan, we all know the story. He basically got hit. He tried to pay off the hackers, told them to be quiet. They agreed. And then immediately after they cashed the check, they they told everybody. And this effect, it's because Uber was a publicly traded company. This affects share prices. Investors had a right to know, et cetera, et cetera. TLDR, Joseph Sullivan, while he was like hung out to dry by the other executives of Uber, he did not he did not do prison time, okay? So, and by the way, ask me a jawjacking about CZ Binance and the $4 billion fine. As I was driving to Thanksgiving dinner, which was like a five-hour drive for me, I was getting so mad thinking about a story that we covered on Wednesday morning. So, like, whoa! Deb Wiggly's in the house. Hey, everybody. Please toss a coin to your Witcher and say hello to Deb Wiggly. If you guys don't know Deb Wiggly in chat, Deb Wiggly is one of the community managers over at Black Hills Information Security, and she's an absolutely delightful professional and human being. Hello, Deb. All right, so TLDR, this guy, after 6 years, he's basically going to come out and do lessons learned. There is nothing more, well, there's a lot of things that are valuable, but one thing that is massive value is getting lessons learned from someone who walked through the fire. Listen to me. I can write a textbook about what it's like to walk through fire. You can watch a video of like someone walking through fire. You can simulate and do VR walking through fire. Get like short of going through the fire physically yourself, getting somebody who went through the fire, give you a firsthand account of what the hell, like, sorry, Kennedy. How hot the fire was, what it felt like on their skin, the thoughts that they had, the decisions they had, the outside factors being influenced, the internal factors influencing. That is gold, man. And listen, there's only one way to do it. You have to walk through the damn fire. And if you know what I mean? Like, so either you're put in that position or you can talk to someone firsthand who's done it. This is going to be freaking gold. I hope to God Black Hat Euro makes this keynote public after the fact. I'm sure they'll pay gated at first and stuff. But anyways, wicked cool. Second of all, best practice, dude. If you're dealing with any type of legal thing, do not talk to the press. Like, I know you want to defend yourself. I know you want like your position. Everybody wants to be the hero in their own story. Most people, like 99% of people are inherently good. And when they make bad decisions, they're doing it with justification in their brain of like, this is a good thing. Like, given all the options, this is a good thing. We've seen the famous psychological study of like, you're standing on the train tracks and you can control whether the train switches tracks. And there's like four children on the train tracks going to get hit by the train. And then there's like an elderly person on the other one. And you have to decide whether or not to pull the lever and have it hit the elderly person or not. Like, both options suck. But when you're thinking like, okay, I'm going to rationalize this, I'm going to justify this because I'm a good person, I'm going to choose what is the, you know, the best option, right? So this one, I'm telling you, following the playbook by not speaking to the press was a good move, even though it made him look guilty, right? All right, let's go.
Lockbit claims cyber attack on India's National Aerospace Lab. On Wednesday, the notorious Lockbit ransomware gang claimed responsibility for a cyber attack targeting India's state-owned National Aerospace Laboratories. NAL's website remained inaccessible, and Lockbit posted 8 purportedly stolen documents, including confidential letters, an employee's passport, and other internal documents. The group threatened to publish the organization's stolen data if it fails to pay an unspecified ransom.
All right, Lockbit, tier one threat actor group. I don't want to support them in any way, but like, I definitely, like, in my mind, there's like a shirt of like Alfie shirt. Like, I don't want to promote them, but like Alfie, Black Cat, Lockbit, they are so tier one. These guys are taking down, you know, national governments. And I know India is a little different in that the states are kind of their own independent things instead of like a united federal thing. But dude, they took down an aerospace lab. No joke. This is, I don't know if they're going to pay. In the United States federal government, I believe they're legally not allowed to pay the ransom. Lockbit's got all this data. They're following the playbook. Again, you got to remember, guys, Lockbit doesn't care if you're India's space, you know, India's version of NASA, or you're Joel Belton's ice cream shop. They hit you, they ransomware you, they throw the node out, they send you the Bitcoin wallet, they give you a number, and they hope you pay, they move on to the next one. It's just a, dude, Lockbit ransomware is basically a manufacturing company.
Great cash, homie.
And they manufacture pain, and they manufacture locked files, or, you know, encrypted files, and that's what they do. So it sucks, all right? So TLDR, I say this with all ransomware threat actors, you, for your organization to implement something that will help you down the road, you should not be looking at Lockbit's IOCs, indicators of compromise. You should not be looking at Lockbit's TTPs and being like, we're good against Lockbit. Unless you are an advanced, mature, optimized cybersecurity program, what you need to do is implement standard best practices, right? Which many of us don't do, frankly, or don't do it well. And I'm not calling out anyone. It's just a reality because of budgets and resources and, you know, the business, right? But dude, here it is. Protection mechanisms, put them in place. Educate your end users so they don't do dumb things. Make sure that you're not using bad passwords. Leverage O365's global banned password list, right? These configurations are mad valuable. Then, more importantly, make sure you're having backups of your critical data. Make sure you're testing the backups. A lot of people don't test their backups, which is idiotic, because when you actually need them, that's not when you should be validating that they work, right? You should definitely validate before that it does work. And finally, huge value, do tabletop exercises often with your business and make sure they understand what the workflow looks like for a ransomware incident. And if I may just offer a quick option, do a ransomware tabletop exercise first with just the IT and cybersecurity people, and I'll tell you why really quickly. One, you're definitely going to be depending on IT a ton when a ransomware recovery incident's happening. So by talking to them and figuring out the things, you're going to work through and get on the same page with them. Second of all, the business won't be there. If I'm trying to like do a tabletop exercise, let's pick somebody, DJ Manny. Okay, so DJ Manny is head of IT at this fictitious company I'm talking about, right? And Deb Wigley is the CEO of the company, okay? So if we do a tabletop exercise and the CEO, Deb Wigley, is there and she's like, what's up? And now I'm like, all right, guys, we got hit with a ransomware. DJ Manny, what do we do? DJ Manny is now going to have this pressure because he's performing in front of the executives, in front of the bosses, to be you know, defending himself, defending his IT team, defending the workflows, being defensive instead of collaborative. So if you collaborate first with the tabletop exercise with just IT, you don't have those external pressures. You don't have those external beings putting pressure on, and you can actually collaborate. You can have more open discourse with them. People can say, I don't know, and they're not fearful that they're going to look bad for performance review in front of their bosses, in front of those people, right? So get on the same page with IT first. Then schedule the tabletop exercise with the larger business. And what's a priority? What do we stand up first? What office do we set up, St. Louis or San Francisco first? What's most important to the business? And you and IT are going to be high-fiving each other and locked arm in arm, because you've already given them the respect and you've already given them the opportunity to admit weakness and do it behind closed doors before moving forward in front of people who, frankly, are going to introduce pressure to those individuals. That's just a pro tip on how to do that a little bit more effectively. Let's go.
And now a word from our sponsor, SpyCloud. SpyCloud has discovered that InfoStealer malware infections are an early warning signal for ransomware. In fact, nearly a third of ransomware victim companies this year were infected with InfoStealer malware like Raccoon, Vidar, or Redline before they were attacked. Are you thinking about InfoStealers as a precursor to ransomware? SpyCloud believes that knowing what criminals have stolen from your managed, unmanaged, and undermanaged infected machines is step one to stopping ransomware attacks. Get SpyCloud's new research on this topic and check your company's exposure from malware infections at spycloud.com/CISO.
All right, couple things really quickly. If you did receive a gifted squad membership, because I saw someone just mention in chat, Brandon Peck, Eric Taylor and Barricade Cyber Solutions gifted 150 squad memberships. And if you want to know how to pick up a squad membership, if you like, Sophie Saborin is on YouTube right now and is not a squad member. Ion Q is on YouTube, but not a squad member. There's gifted subs to be had. Grab them up. You have to opt into casually. Joseph, how are you not a squad member? You work for Eric Taylor. Like, go use the link in the gift. You see the redeemed code right here? Just click on that link and you'll get a pop-up on YouTube to opt in. Now, if you don't want to opt in, that's cool. Don't worry about that. But let's go. All right. What are we doing here? All right, guys. I want to holler at all of you. What's up, Poner Joe? If you're in chat, I see you DMing me. Good to see you guys. Hey, thank you all. We got 445 of you beautiful people here this morning. We went around the world, minus Australia. Good day, mate. But I want to thank all of you. If you're getting value from the show, there's 445 of you here. Guys, hit the like button. It's not for my, I'm not saying hit the sub, hit the bell for notifications, blah, YouTube, like diatribe. Hit the like button. It goes a long way to helping other people find the channel. If you're a first timer in chat right now, hashtag first timer in chat. Obviously, we'd love to welcome our first timers. But also, you may have found us because people hit the like button yesterday. So pay it forward. Be part of the community. Hit the like button. Okay? It goes a long way to triggering the YouTube algorithm. I also want to say shout out to the other stream sponsor, Antisyphon Training. Guys, Antisyphon Training is disrupting the traditional training industry by providing high quality, cutting edge education to everyone, regardless of their financial position. If you want to receive top notch cybersecurity training for free from industry experts, I'm talking decades of experience. Go use the link in the description below to Antisyphon Training. This isn't a trick. This isn't some weird lead gen thing. This is legit, okay? Go there. Go to training. I'm doing it on stream if you're watching right now. Go on to... hold on. You have to... Hold on. You got to go to training. Go to pay what you can training. And all of these trainings right here, look at the calendar. All these trainings can be yours for $0. And I want to say $0. I want to call your attention to these two, active defense and cyber deception and SOC core skills. John Strand, the man has an emote on the squad memberships walking through fire. The guy, if you don't know John Strand, check him out. Black Hills John Strand. The guy is setting the tone for how we give back. If you like what I'm doing with Simply Cyber, John Strand is Simply Cyber, turn to 11, Spinal Tap style. Go check it out. Get some free training. Holler, holler, holler. Also, really quickly, in mods, I don't know if you're going to be able to do this, but there is a training this Friday. Deb Wigley, maybe you can help. There's a training this Friday for active countermeasures, a free 6-hour cyber threat hunting course. I signed up for it yesterday. I will be taking it. I will be in the course. If you want to take a course with me this Friday, 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. Eastern time, shout out. We can do it together. We can be in Discord. We can hang out and high five. Ask me a jaw jacket and I'll get more information for you. Guys, hashtag Simply Cyber Community Challenge. Ashiana Ishmael currently has the baton. Let me tell you about this, guys. If you want to supercharge your LinkedIn feed and make LinkedIn a powerful tool for you for $0, do the following. Go on LinkedIn and search for this hashtag, hashtag Simply Cyber Community Challenge. Once you find it, find the people who are posting. Look for Ashiana Ishmael's post. Look for Keith Ferguson's post, right? Look for these posts. Okay, then connect with the poster. Comment on their post and connect with the people in comments. Because you're commenting on the post, the next person's going to connect with you. So for 5 minutes a day, you get a bunch of new connections, and then passively, other people are connecting with you from the community because you're in the comments. I guarantee you, 5 minutes a day, this is a guarantee. Stone Cold Walk Pick of the Week, 5 minutes a day, 2 weeks' time, your LinkedIn feed is going to modify, and it's going to be more valuable. It's going to be meaningful connections. You're going to see lots of valuable content in your feeds. Believe me, that's what's up. All right, so if Ashiana Ishmael can do me a favor, tag somebody in chat. I see some people saying that they want the baton, Ashiana. By the way, yeah, Ashiana's in chat. So Ashiana, it's on you to tag somebody just like you were tagged yesterday as well. I want to say shout out to the first timers. I see Zach Ames and Big Chip in chat.
Welcome to the party, pal.
Hold on, let's get that better.
Welcome to the party, pal.
Welcome to the party, pal. Big Chip, Ashiana, Big Chip and Zach Ames, welcome to the party, pal. Great to have you guys here. I hope you're getting value from the stream. We already did Worldwide Wednesday, so there's no activity here at the mid-roll. And I've got this. Hold on 1 second. Hold on. This is just coming in hot across the link here. Threat hunting. Is this the right one for tomorrow, for this Friday? Okay, hold on. This came through, but I'm really not sure. Yes, December 1st. Okay, so check it out. This is December 1st training. I'm going to drop a link in chat. I'm going to be doing this training Friday, December 1st, 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, free training. If you want to do a training with me, I'll be a student. I'll be in chat. I'll be engaging. Let's do a Simply Cyber community class course together. There's the link in chat. Giddy up on it. Let's keep going.
Experts warn of critical own cloud vulnerability being exploited. Threat actors have started exploiting a maximum severity vulnerability in open source file sharing and collaboration software OwnCloud just days after its public disclosure. The issue impacts Graph API app versions 0.2.0 to 0.3.0, allowing attackers to retrieve credentials, license keys, and other system info. However, the flaw cannot be mitigated by simply disabling the Graph API app. The recommended fix includes deleting the app's PHP file and changing potentially exposed admin passwords, access keys, and mail server and database passwords. On Monday, CISA included the bugs in its weekly vulnerability roundup, while Shadow Server Foundation said it has identified roughly 11,000 internet-exposed own cloud instances which are potentially at risk.
Damn, man. Well, this sucks. Okay, here's the TLDR. This story has been basically in our daily cyber threat briefing. This is the third time in 1 week that this has been here. Oh, Keith Ferguson. Cool. We'll be able to do that. The VO888, if you want to opt in, look at what the bot is about to say. Exclamation point gift. In chat, you're going to see the bot drop that right there. This is how you do it, this link. It's a YouTube link. You click on it and it'll, you know. All right, third time in a week this story is showing up. Own cloud is basically, it's like a localized cloud instance, right? So your staff, your people, your family, whatever, can move stuff off their desktop, off their thing, and push it up to some type of like network attached storage device. The concept of own cloud is not new. It's basically just a file server, right? A localized file server. The own cloud software is incredibly vulnerable. It's incredibly easy to exploit. I don't know at this point if there's like a point and click to exploit it, but a lot of times these things, like, you've reached peak meme if there is a Metasploit framework module that you just point and fire and take it over. They're saying that there's over 11,000 instances currently out there. They're probably using Shodan or some, I would assume Shodan, to discover this. I've said this before, I'll say it again. For practitioners in the industry, if you're running own cloud, you need to address this immediately. If you don't know if you're running own cloud, right? Like, you can't prove a negative. So maybe you are running in it and don't know. And I'll give you a hint why. So you might have end users in your environment who are trying to do the right thing and set up their own file server, own cloud, because they're partnering with a different department, or they don't want to bother IT. Or a lot of times, I'll tell you what, if you have a mature InfoSec program and you're like, listen, we're not going to allow people to stand up their own software, you're not allowed to do that. Well, people who want to are like, oh man, like, I want a file server, but IT won't let me. I want a file server, but InfoSec won't let me. Here, I Googled something and own cloud can do it. Let's stand it up. And now you've got this shadow IT, this unmanaged infrastructure that's totally exposing your stuff. Ah, you got to patch it. Where's my patch? Ah, you got to patch it. All right. So I love it. Thank you, Stephanie and team, who started using the new emote. I forgot about that, but hilarious.
Ah, you got
to
patch it.
So use Shodan Monitor. So if you go to monitor.shodan.io, that's a website, monitor.shodan.io, you can scan, you can proactively scan your own IP range, but you can use Shodan to look at your external IP range and see if you are running an own cloud instance in your IP range. Remember, RFC 1918 defines what private IP ranges are. Those are your 10.x.x.x, your 172. Is it 172.16 to 172.32 and 192.168? There are private IP address ranges that you don't need to look for. But if you have external IP addresses, because through an ISP or whatever, those are the ones you need to look for, okay, for own cloud. If you're running own cloud and you're not taking care of it, you are literally playing with fire. You are running pants off, backwards, full speed through a cornfield. You are going to get impacted, okay? Kind of sorry, Kennedy. That one's a deeper thought.
Google disputes workspace design flaw identified by researchers. According to Hunter Security, a flaw in Google Workspace's domain-wide delegation feature gives attackers a way to steal Gmail emails, exfiltrate data from Google Drive, and take unauthorized actions against Google Workspace APIs. Hunters released proof of concept code on GitHub this week to demonstrate the attacks against the flaw, which it has dubbed Delafriend. However, Google rejected Hunter's characterization of the issues as a design flaw, saying the report did not identify an underlying security issue in Google products. Google did encourage users to make sure all accounts have the least amount of privilege possible to combat these types of attacks.
All right. So a security vendor report came out. You got to be careful. Well, hold on. There's a couple things here, okay? Hunter Security said that Google's Workspace domain-wide delegation feature gave attackers a way to steal sensitive data from Google Drive, Gmail, all these things. And Google is basically saying, this isn't true. You need to implement basically least privilege permissions. Okay, let me tell you a couple things here, okay? And this comes straight from the mouth of Eric Taylor. Okay, so I'm invoking my local Eric Taylor instance. For organizations that are leveraging cloud for their primary IT infrastructure, you basically have two choices. You have Microsoft Office 365 and you have Google Workspaces. Now, Microsoft Office 365 allows you a lot of configuration, a lot of lockdown, a lot of features, right? So it's awesome. But it requires a lot of knowledge, a lot of skill, a lot of experience to be able to configure it appropriately. Think of it, ironically, as like an Android device, okay, versus an iPhone. And I say ironically because Android is by Google, and Google is going to be like Apple in this case. But think of Office 365 as like an Android device. Massive customization. It allows practitioners to really lock it down. Now, compare that to Google Workspaces. Google Workspaces is very Apple-ish in that it's like very bubblegummy. It's very easy to deploy. You know, it's perfect for small businesses that don't have the skill or experience. A lot of big tech startups use Google Workspaces for their stuff. And while it's not natively insecure, the amount of customization, the amount of configuration, the amount of hardening is not at the level that Office 365 offers. So in both instances, you do need skill and experience and knowledge in order to configure them well. But Google Workspaces, it sounds like what they're saying here is that it sounds like Google is saying Google Workspaces is secure, but it's more about administrative policy, administrative controls, good process, right? Like that's what they're saying. They're saying, hey, when you are an engineer and you're deploying a new user or you're deploying some type of resource into your Google Workspace, it's incumbent upon you to use least privilege principles. AC6, by the way, just I do love my NIST 853. Let me see if AC6 is least privilege. No. NIST control. Sorry, this is me just indulging myself because I do love... Oh, look at that. Nailed it. Okay, I'm such a nerd for NIST. I love NIST. All right, where's my NIST? I love NIST bucket. There we go. Anytime I see a control and I can quickly call out the NIST control, it gives me great pleasure. So anyways, they're saying it's on you as the engineer deploying permissions and everything to do it. So this essentially what Google is saying is this isn't a security risk. This is a feature that they give you, right? So unfortunately, you would almost hope that by default, they would make it locked down and you'd have to unlock things. But as I told my Citadel students yesterday, and I'll move on after this story, after this little thing, if you think about it from a vendor perspective, vendors have a very perverse incentive to make things insecure by default. I've said this before on the stream. Think of a straight line, and on one end you've got secure, and on one end you have usable. And somewhere in the middle is a slider bar. The more usable you make something, the less secure it is. And the more secure, the more usable you make it, the less secure it is. The more secure you make it, the less usable it is, right? Obviously, a computer turned off in a safe thrown in the bottom of the ocean, no one's hacking that, but no one can use it. Something that is turned on, a kiosk in an open air mall with access to everything and you don't even have to log in, that's wicked insecure. But guess what? No one's complaining about being able to use it, right? So our job in InfoSec, especially GRC people, holla GRC, what's up, Alana, is to find where that slider goes and actually manually adjust it in real time based on threat landscape and data and a million other things. But my point is, Google has this perverse incentive to make it very usable because they don't want people to complain and be like, oh my God, Google Workspaces sucks. It's so hard to use. Everything's locked down. I try to do anything and I got to do X, Y, and Z every single time. F it. Let's go to Office 365. So because of that perverse incentive, they do this, but then they say things like this where like, yeah, it's really usable, but it's incumbent upon you to make sure that you're doing all the controls to make sure that it's a little slid closer to the security side. That's what's up.
ID theft service resold by cyber criminals. According to Krebs on Security, since at least February of this year, a cyber criminal service advertised it.
All right, we can hold on really quickly. We can have a full-on discussion with Josh Mason in Jawjacking. He's arguing that my line about a straight line and accessibility and security is not a straight line. It's not zero sum. I do disagree, and we could talk about that later.
Jackie Chan, U.S. is Lookups, allows anyone to look up an SSN or background report on virtually any American. For anywhere between $8 and $40 in virtual currency, a bot will return a detailed customer background report in just a few moments. The service's Telegram channel features sample background reports, including that of President Joe Biden and podcaster Joe Rogan. Report data includes the subject's date of birth, addresses, phone numbers, employers, known relatives and associates, and driver's license information. Jackie Chan abuses the name and trademarks of Columbus, Ohio-based data broker US InfoSearch, whose website says it provides risk management, identity, and fraud prevention services.
All right. So, you know what? An enterprising individual... there's an enterprising individual who figured out how to make data available in a very easy to purchase way. So here's the deal. We might even have to have a live stream about the security and usability because, like, I'm passionately positioned philosophically on that position. All right, so check it out. ID theft service resold. So. Okay, so data gets stolen all the time, right? My data, your data, Simple Man Guitar's data, Randall Lundy's data, everybody's data. Like, hold on. As much as I don't want to appropriate this, Oprah, your data gets sold. Your data gets sold, okay? But it's always like this, like, mysterious, oh, you've got to go on the dark web. You've got to buy bundles of data. You've got to... you know, get all these Excel spreadsheets and stuff. Like, how do you operationalize this? How do you make it accessible to people who want to buy it, right? You could have the coolest product on the planet, but if you can't get it to market, if you can't get it to the consumers, they can't buy it. So this individual got it that last mile, if you will. Hold on. I'm going to close Discord. I can't right now. So listen, the final mile is making it accessible to the consumer. So this individual set up a Telegram group that allows you to ping them, pay them, and then download the PDF. So I'm sure, here's the thing. This is more, I almost feel like the people who are buying this are more curious than anything. Like, if you're a real threat actor who's going to operationalize phishing attacks and targeting high value net worth individuals and stuff like that, you're probably not using this methodology, but as a gig economy, way to go. Again, I don't support this. I don't sponsor this, but this is another indication of how Telegram has been essentially weaponized for communication, coordination, and, you know, basically operations of threat actor groups, whether it's coordinating cyber threat attack targets or literally running their business. This is what's up. I also want to point out, not to be flippant about this, but in the United States, guys, data brokers do this too. So as much as this guy's wares are being sold because of a data theft, so they're criminal in their origin, you technically could buy this data off a data broker legally. I don't think you could legally turn around and sell it. I'm sure when you purchase it from a data broker, there's a contract that says you won't turn around and sell it because that would go against the data broker's business. But if I'm downloading Olivia Rodrigo's information in order to perpetrate a phishing attack or social engineering attack, I could legally buy this very likely from a data broker. Okay. Data brokers are really, really unbelievable, frankly. And again, if you want to know the extent of how crazy data brokers are in the United States. I offer you this this video. This video is a little old. It's John Oliver's Last Week Tonight. But if you want to do a quick like lesson learned on data brokers, this is a phenomenal video to check out.
Bots make up 30% of internet traffic. According to a report from Data Dome, malicious bots are plaguing the internet, accounting for over 30% of all internet traffic, which cybercriminals use to target online businesses with fraud and other attacks. The report also reveals that traditional CAPTCHAs are no longer an effective tool in preventing automated attacks. Finally, the report indicates that 68% of U.S. websites lack adequate protection to defend against bot attacks.
All right. We do know about bots. Bots are everywhere. Bots are basically like automated zombie users that are used to do all sorts of things. I just gave a lecture yesterday on denial of service attacks in 2023 and how distributed denial of service attacks are the way it's done. And one technique, it's not the only technique, but one technique to effectively do a distributed denial of service attack is through bots, botnets, bot herding, and doing that. Now, and making up 30% of the internet traffic is interesting. And remember, bots are not all malicious. I don't know if this story goes into it, but like a lot of people, like there's bots that help do automation. There's bots like, guys, like Barricade Cyber's webpage right here. Chat with Billy. Billy's probably a bot. Billy's probably not somebody sitting there waiting for someone to come to this website and chat with them, right? So there are righteous, appropriate. Have a good one, Natalie Garrett. There's righteous, appropriate use cases for bots. So to me, like, okay, interesting 30% of internet traffic, but it's not necessarily malicious. It's intentional. They do say here in their findings, 10% blocked false bot request. Looks like they're looking just at bots that are doing malicious stuff. I don't know what a Google bot is, but... anyways, I would actually suggest looking into bots, bot development. With the amount of AI out there and automation, like bots can help you. Again, they can be totally weaponized and, you know, used. But guys, if the internet, right, the same internet everybody uses, if 30% of all internet traffic is bots, you have to imagine that there's some viable utility to bots, whether it's malicious or righteous. This amount of traffic definitely indicates that it's legit, and that's what's up. All right, Kimberly with the gifted subs. I would just, if I was a I am a practitioner, but what I would suggest is you can't really do anything about this. You can't stop bot traffic from happening. It is what it is. Thank you so much, Kimberly, for the super subs.
Did we just become best friends?
Yep. All right, guys, we're a couple minutes over. Sorry about that. Let me do this. If you were here for the news, thank you so very much. 389 of you. I know many of you dropped off for 9 o'clock. Many of you probably had meetings. I want to remind everybody that tomorrow at 4:30 p.m., we are going live with Gary Binder. If you wanted to know everything that you didn't know you wanted to know about post-quantum cryptography, Q-Day, what computers are going to look like after we crack quantum, after we solve the cooling problem. Hey, is all the AES data traffic that foreign countries are stockpiling going to be a problem? I don't know. Let's ask Gary Binder. Come join us. I'll drop a link in chat right now to this stream. It's going to be good times. I hope you enjoy. Guys, if you had to go, if you had to boogie out of here, I understand. I appreciate it. We'll be here tomorrow at 8 a.m. Eastern time for the Simply Cyber Daily Cyber Threat Briefing. Tomorrow is Dan Reardon, a.k.a. Haircut Fish's meme of the week. We didn't have one for Thanksgiving, so he's in the chute and ready to deliver. I want to say shout out to Simply Man Guitar for accepting the Simply Cyber Community Challenge. Simply Man Guitar, we look forward to your post on LinkedIn. Everybody go out and check it out. Remember, guys, there are tons of gifted subs still to be had. Do !GIFT. Click on the link and take on those things. You're welcome, priority problem solvers. All right, guys, if you got to go, peace out. If you got to stay, we are about to do jawjacking. For all of those that are first timers. We do this every day of the week normally, and it's called Jaw Jacking, and we're about to kick it. I got a lot to share with you, but let's do it. Take care, everybody. Be well. All right, everybody, what's up? Welcome to Jaw Jacking. I am your host, Jerry Guy, looking very similar to Dr. Gerald Auger. We're going to kick it old school and hang out for about 30 minutes. If you got any questions, drop them in chat. I'd love to share whatever knowledge I have with you and connect you with resources, make it all available. Rex Cognito with the gifted subs.
Can we just become best friends? Yep.
Thank you so much, Rex Cognito. Love it, love it, love it. Guys, I got a couple cool things to share with you already right off the top of the hour. Some of you already saw this, but guys, there's a free threat hunting course with labs hands-on being taught by an absolute expert, Chris Brenton, on Friday this week. I know it's short notice. If you have the availability on Friday to come take this class, I will be in the class. It's a free class, $0. You can register. I'll drop a link in chat. You can register right here. I'll be active in chat. Here's the thing. I've been super busy many of you know this. I've been trying to take December off, and by off, I just mean doing less work. But because I've set myself up for success, I have the bandwidth to take this class, and I'm super pumped about it. I haven't done professional development short of reading books, in months. And I'm thirsty for knowledge, so I can't wait. I hope you take the class with me. And if you can't, maybe grab the next one. William K99. All right, I want to share another cool thing with you. Oh, cool. Hey, Josh Mason will be in the class, so me and Josh Mason will be there. Yes, Tony Jack, the gifted subs are given randomly, but you do have to opt in to receive them. Here is the code to do that for sure. Guys, I want to share this with you too. And let me know what your thoughts are on this one way or the other. I've started kind of screwing around a little bit. Hold on, let me see this. So I don't know about you guys, but it's really, really common for me to, you know, get off stream, get heads down, start cranking out work. I'm currently working on my Cyber 101 course. It's about halfway done. I've got big announcements for you on December 13th at the All Hands call. But what I wanted to tell you is I personally like to throw on music. Normally, this TV right here, that's a YouTube channel that's playing lo-fi music right now. I just mute it for the stream. And I love the background. It's ambiance. It makes me feel that there's energy in the room while I'm working. I don't know if you work from home or you work in an office, but for me, the way I roll, I need music. I think I have ADD, honestly, but like I need input. I need activity. I need things going on for me to be able to zero in and focus. And just for screwing around purposes, many of you may or may not know this, but I have another channel called Simply Cyber Cafe, and I'll drop a link to it in chat. But what I've started doing is I've started tinkering around with doing my own kind of 24/7 lo-fi video feeds. I did it a couple times yesterday. Some people dropped in chat. I saw Jesse Johnson there. I saw, Toasty Pops there. Saw a lot of people there. So if that's what you're into, come check it out. I would love, thanks Dream Logic, you know what's up. I would love, just give it a sub. I'm going to do it again when I get off stream today, play the music. You could see here, I'll just show you, like there's these like animated GIF things. There's a couple different ones that I do. The music's really good. If you're into that, come check it out. And the reason I'm saying come check it out is A, I hope it makes your workday a little bit more enjoyable, makes you a little bit more productive. And on top of that, DMs are open. Live stream chat is open. If you have feedback on the music, on the look and feel, on ways to make it better, guys, I serve the Simply Cyber community, but you guys always have such wonderful ideas. So I'm soliciting feedback on this project to make it as good and as useful to the community as possible. So that's all I'll say about that. Now, let me turn it. Let me open Discord back up. I was getting distracted by all the stuff with Josh Mason. All right. Carrie's got a question. About to give up on career in IT, wondering, since I'm throwing ideas against the wall, nothing is stuck. Is there anything I can learn fast to do as a job online? So let me see, Carrie. I don't know. I mean, my focus is so narrowly focused on cybersecurity and doing those things. I mean, Carrie, you know, honestly, I know you said you're giving up on a career in IT. I got to tell you two things. One, help desk support, IT support. Those jobs, there's a lot of them. It's hard. It's hard work. It's a grind. But a lot of people start their career from there, right? So that might be an opportunity to look at, Carrie. You know, do that for 6 months a year. Make the connections. Get that IT experience. Move forward in your career. Two, KevTech IT, he's got great content on how to be super effective at support desk, help desk. Third, and a priority for Carrie and really for anyone else in chat, you've got to have the mindset. You've got to have a positive mindset. You can't be self-deprecating. You can't, like, people feed off the energy of an individual, and people also look for the individual to define how they see themselves. So, you know, if you're saying, like, oh, I'm not good, like, hi, I'm interested in this job, although I'm probably not the best candidate, like, that's not going to help your cause, right? You need to be optimistic. You got to be real, right? You can't be like, I'm the best candidate, period, end of story. Don't even bother looking, because that's a little arrogant. But you've got to have a positive mindset, have a positive outlook. And this goes for anyone, not just Carrie. But think about all the work you've put in. Think about all the connections you've made. As you're going into the job interview, I am going to crush this job interview. I am the best candidate for this job, and shine for that interview, right? That's what I would suggest, okay? What's up, Chris Young? Good to see you. All right, let's keep rolling. Yeah, so Carrie, also worth noting, I don't know what the opportunities are in your area, but, you know, obviously remote jobs. I don't know if traveling, you know, like my first job out of college, I had to travel 45 minutes in a car, 50 minutes with traffic sometimes, to get to work. And I did that for a year. I quit on my 1 year anniversary because that job was exploiting me. Also, fun fact, I'll tell that story some other time. Fun fact, when I interviewed and they gave me the job offer, they literally told me that they were going to exploit me. No, effing around, no skirting around it, no putting lipstick on a pig. Literally, the owner of the company is like, here's what I'm going to pay you. I know it's way under market value, but you know what? That's what I'm going to pay you, and you're going to accept the job because I can see on your resume, or I can see that you've been looking for a job for 4 months and you can't find one. So you need this job more than I need you. So, you know, you can do whatever you want. You can squirm, you can try to negotiate, but this is the price, and I guarantee you, you're going to accept this job. And that was such a freaking bitter pill to swallow, because I did take the job. I did crush it. And I gladly quit on my 1 year anniversary. I was so happy to tell him to go take the job and kiss my A. Sorry, Kennedy. All right, let's keep going. What's up? Oh, I know, Nick Barker. Don't even get me started. Hey, you know what? I like to think of myself as a really positive guy, glass half full guy. I met Mrs. Auger at that job. I started on like a Monday. Mrs. Auger started on a Tuesday. They introduced me to her. I was dumbfounded, godsmacked, lightning struck. It's so weird. I think that this would be borderline a major issue, but like literally, okay, this is true. And I've said this for years, and thank God it worked out. Nick Barker, the moment I was introduced to my wife, I knew I was going to be with her. I knew it. I had a girlfriend at the time. She had a boyfriend at the time. The second I was introduced to her, I said, that's it. She's the one. Lightning struck, dude. And then obviously I married her. So I did everything in my power to make it happen. And it happened. All right, let's keep going. What do you think about the ISE2 CGRC cert for GRC? Fella Dada works. Let's see.
Did we just become best friends?
Yep.
Fella Dada, thanks for the super chat. Going to answer your question. Let me do it on stream live. I don't know this cert off the back of my hand. So let me do this. ISE2 CGRC cert. All right, let's look at it. This is how I evaluate things. Here we go. Here we go. Whenever you're evaluating a cert, two things you should do is, one, you should look at what they cover, and then two, see what job recs are asking for it. It requires 2 years of experience. It's 85-71 compliant, which basically means this means that the U.S. government has job postings that require it. All right, so GRC, here we go. Program management, that's fine. Scoping, cool. Select. This is NIST. All right, I've already covered this before. Okay, so check this out. This is what this is. This is a fine cert. It has major gaps in it, okay? Hold on. The super chats are coming in. All right, hold on 1 second. This is a good cert, but it's got major gaps. Look at this. 37? Look at this. And if you got a moment in chat, iHeart NIST would be fine. I'll do it really quickly. iHeart NIST. This is NIST 837. ISC basically took the NIST 837. They took this, right? And they put it into a cert. Ready? Phase zero. Phase one, phase two, right? So scoping, control selection, control implementation, control audit, control approval, CM. Now let's look. Overall program, control selection, control implementation, control assessment, control authorization, CM. That's all this is. So if you want to learn 837, if you want to be able to do, you know, FISMA compliance and stuff like that, this is probably a fine control. Okay, this is probably a fine control. But it doesn't do anything with information security awareness. This doesn't do anything with risk assessment. Those are two major areas in GRC. Like, if you don't know how to do risk assessment, I recommend you learn it because it's an incredible skill. Also, not that this is a, I didn't plant that question, obviously, but just to tell you guys, my GRC course right now is 30% off until Friday with code SimplyCyber30. And I don't think I can show you right now, but basically it has five modules. Three of them are involved this. And also there's an entire lecture in there that goes over this entire thing. It's like an hour plus long lecture. It goes over this exact entire framework and what it is and why they do it and everything. But the gaps inside this right here, InfoSec awareness and risk, I do a full deep dive breakdown on those two. The final thing I would say, let's do LinkedIn jobs really quickly. And then I'll get to those super chats that came in. Let's look at the jobs. All right, CGRC. I'm looking for this cert, okay? Come on, man. All right, so is it CGRC? Oh my God, dude. All right, so CGRC, do you see the CGRC? On LinkedIn, I'm seeing zero jobs asking for it. All right, So on LinkedIn, which is just one job posting, I'm seeing zero jobs asking for it. So it's a cool cert. It'll probably give you some education on how to do 837 RMF. Maybe you can leverage it. But for me, using it as a tool to make your resume jump out, no one's asking for it. The market is not asking for that certification. So I don't know, you know, if you can get your business to pay for it, go for it. But I don't see the return on the investment, frankly. My LinkedIn's super dark. Yeah, it's in dark mode. All right, let's keep going really quickly through the super chats here really quick. Lazaro with the super chat. Now, Lazaro is our own community member who's going through job interviews right now. Just to add this, I deal with complex PTSD, but don't let it bring me down. No matter how tough some days can get, we just have to keep pushing through life, no matter the difficulties.
Did we just become best friends?
Yep.
Thank you for the super chat, and thank you for the personal story, Lazaro, and sharing in the community. Love it, love it, love it. Nerman sharing a super chat.
Did we just become best friends?
Yep.
Hey, Gerald, Dr. Gerald, I just finished reading a book, Tracers in the Dark, the one you recommended. It is amazing. Hell yeah, Nerman. Sorry, Kennedy. Tracers in the Dark is good. I got to tell you, Nerman, that last chapter on Welcome to Video is dark. I couldn't read that chapter. I listened to the Darknet Diaries on it, which was enough. But yeah, hella good book. If you guys are looking for a good book, Tracers in the Dark by Andy Greenberg is really good. He's a author and he's a Wired reporter. This book right here, so good. Definitely worth checking out. Thanks for sharing that feedback. All right, let's keep going. Can anybody recommend good Kali Linux tutorials? Zatalpa says. If you want, there's like a Metasploitable one that kind of gets you started and going. Rich Palmer has a similar story. Wife just clicked for him talking about marriage way too soon. Yeah, hey, Rich Palmer, I wasn't even dating my wife, and I told her I was going to marry her. I moved away to Washington, D.C. When I quit my job there, and I said, I have to go to D.C. for a year. Believe me, I'm going to marry you. But for me to be able to provide for you and our family, which we don't have yet, I need to go to DC to get this experience working at the Pentagon. I'm going to be able to leverage it into the hills. And I have since, and we've had a wonderful life, but dude, it's crazy to be talking to someone who you're not even dating and tell them that you're going to marry them and not have them mace you in the face. but Rich Palmer, super pumped for you. Congratulations on your marriage and finding your one. Rhonda Rummerfield knows what's up. Congratulations, Rhonda, on your marriage, and congratulations. Mrs. and I are celebrating 18 years together. So we've been together a minute. Let's keep going here. David Beard wants to know, what's the deal with ISO 27001? ISO 27001 is a security framework. It's mostly used in Europe. I don't really operate in Europe, so I don't have experience, nor do I mess around with it. It is a little antiquated. It's good, but it's not great in my opinion. What I will say, whether it's ISO 27001, NIST Cybersecurity Framework, CIS 18, or whatever flavor of the week it is, all compliance security frameworks, 80% of their controls are the same, okay? It's the 20% that makes them a little different. I'm a huge advocate of NIST Cybersecurity Framework. Let's go. All right, let's keep going here. I'm looking at chat. Hold on. Nerman sent over a super chat. Nerman with a super chat. Thanks, Nerman.
Did we just become best friends?
Yep.
Talking about the last few chapters of Tracers in the Dark, it does get dark. It gets into like basically child sexual abuse material. Online websites using Bitcoin to facilitate access to those websites and do horrible, horrible things. Again, I couldn't even read that chapter personally. Continuing to look at chat. Hey, Alana, have a good one. Be well. People are recommending the XM Cyber course. Oh, that's another update, guys. Really quickly, the XM Cyber course. I did this course commissioned work. So I got paid a flat rate to do, thank you. Thanks, Josh Mason. I could see I did this as a commissioned work. But I want to tell everybody that I know some of you have been trying to register for this course and having issues. I've messaged XM Cyber and asked them about how to make this accessible to more people. Because I get, dude, if you got laid off, you don't have a business email. If you work as a heavy machine equipment operator, you might not have a business email. So it's not fair to exclude those people. Anyways, go check out this course. It's free. Those who have done it have said really nice things. I don't do anything halfway. I like to push quality. So I think that this is a really great course and I'm happy with the way it came out. Oh my God. Rex Cognition. I always thought it was Rich Cognito. I'm sorry, Rex. Tell me how to pronounce your name. Drop a phonetic key. You're always doing super chats and being actively engaged in the community. I will say your name right. I'm sorry. Holy crap. Yeah, if we could get Andy Greenberg on the channel, that would be sick. Hold on. We've got an update. Pause the music. Cameron Razavi has just accepted an offer for my first full-time position as an IR specialist at a major aerospace company. I came in like a Yes, 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 Cameron, we love it. Congratulations, so pumped for you. That is awesome. Well done. I'm so, so happy for you, Cameron. Very, very cool. Congratulations, so cool. Very nice. All right, let's go. Network Chuck's got good videos for sure. Hacker Sploit's got great content. Let's see. Let's go. Hold on. CJ has a friend moving his SMB to 0365. What should he be looking for? Also, what can I talk to him about to help? Really quickly, CJ, who I know CJ out in Vegas, very nice person, very nice guy. Check this out, CJ. You want to drop some knowledge bombs. Look at this. Soteria is a company inside of Charleston, South Carolina. They're a small company. They're run by a former NSA TAC guy, a TAO guy, excuse me, who I love. He's a great friend of mine. Check this out. They wrote a free tool called Soteria 365 Inspect. And what it does is it'll go through your Office 365 instance and look at your configuration and point out best practices and low-hanging fruit that you don't have configured correctly. Check this out, CJ. This could be a really good utility for your friend. It's a GitHub repo, okay? Totally safe. I would check that out. All right, here we go. We've got a super chat coming in hot from Rex. From experience, CP incidents in IT and responding is nerve-wracking. CP incidents. What's CP incidents? CP. Rob L. Rob L. says, XM Cyber says it's maxed out. How is that possible? It's an online asynchronous course. How the hell is it maxed out? Sorry. How the hell? Sorry. How is it maxed out? That doesn't make sense to me. I'll tell you, when I did that course for XM Cyber, I tried to take less money and retain the rights to the intellectual property of the course so I could release it, but they weren't having that. Nathan Bullen, I've never heard of TISAX frameworks. I can't really comment on that. Let's see. Where are we at? 9:33. I'm going to have to get going in a minute. Let's go. I don't know what CP incidents mean, Rex. I thank you for the super chat.
Best friends. Yep.
Let's go here. AMA. We're just doing AMA stuff right now. If you're just joining, having a good time. 273 of you beautiful people here. What do you think about new Hack the Box certified defense security analyst cert? Yeah, casually, Joseph, I don't know if you're asking me what CSAM acronym means or you're sharing it as an acronym to use. Let me know. Hack the Box. D Crash is asking about Hack the Box. Let's take a look. Hack the Box certified defensive security analyst cert. So let me check that. Let me tell you a couple things really quickly. One, for the longest time, like offensive security, you know, training was where it's at. But because a lot more jobs are in the SOC and there's a lot more need for the SOC and a lot more businesses are asking for SOC analysts, there's been a market shift for SOC analyst training, SOC analyst certs. It's literally so hot right now.
That Hansel's so hot right now.
Okay, so it's no surprise that Hack the Box has released this. Try Hack Me's probably done it. I know Let's Defend, which, by the way, you can get, I think, 50% off Let's Defend right now. Oh, thank you, Rex. Rex Cognitionis. 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 Rex Cognitionis. Cognitionis? Rex Cognitionis. All right. Rex Cognitionis. Rex Cognitionis. I'll do my best, Rex. Thanks for the super chat.
Did we just become
okay, so getting back to this. I will say Hack the Box does do good. I've liked Hack the Box for a while. If they cover these knowledge domains, that's really good. Elk and Splunk is good to know. Understanding SOC is good. Log analysis is good. Threat hunting is a skill that's definitely needed. Let's see what the cert does. All right. I can't, there isn't much information here to go on. It's hard for me to tell whether or not this thing goes deep or not. Let me see. Yeah, it does go into that. What's the pricing on this? $490 for a annual subscription and an exam voucher. You can do it for less. You could get it for $218 if you go month to month. So if you escalate it hardcore. And if you want just getting the SOC path modules and exam voucher, it's $320. So, I mean, I would argue, dude, $320 for a lot of education and a cert exam from a well-known organization. A lot of people know Hack the Box. That could be really valuable. I'll tell you what, I'll add it to my, so I have like, I have the way I track work and the way I track things. I have kind of an ideas bucket. So I'll add it to the ideas bucket. If I had time, Hack the Box SOC analyst training path. If I can get like Hack the Box to like, give it to me for free so I can take it or pay me to take it, I will do that and make a video and stuff on it. Also, just another quick thing to share with everybody. Hold on, let me see this. What's the deal? All right, hold on. Okay, so hey, Matthew Netchy is sharing in chat that he got the message that the class was maxed out for personal email. And then when he set it up with his work email, he was able to get in. So it sounds like XM Cyber is gating it. I've sent them an email and asked them to give me some options that can be done. But if you need access today, I would recommend using a business email or spending a couple bucks registering a domain and you know, using that as a business email. Get a friend who has a business email, I guess. You know, I don't know. It's not my course. I mean, I made it and sold it to them wholesale. So I don't have oversight and, administrative access to those things. Cognitionis. Okay. All right. It's 9:39. I have a 10 a.m. meeting with our very own Eric Taylor. I'll make you a deal, guys. I'll go a couple more minutes, 6 minutes, and then I've got to take a bio break and get a new cup of coffee before I get on to my 10 a.m. meeting. I just want to remind everybody, Security Blue Team, Josh Mason recommends for learning. You're welcome, Chris Young. My pleasure. My pleasure. Just so you guys know, to get like a little bit of a hype going, where is it? Just to get a little bit of hype going. If you guys don't know, I'm doing Advent of Cyber. If you don't know what Advent of Cyber is, it's a really cool thing that TriHackMe does every holiday season. 25 days of rooms and challenges, and there's like a cohesive storyline. This guy, two thumbs and all smiles, is doing day 5 this year. This is my thumbnail. If you're interested, go check out Advent of Cyber, TriHackMe/Christmas, I think. But it's a lot of fun. And DJ BSEC, can you drop your Twitch, BSEC? DJ BSEC is going to be doing live streams every day of the rooms. Obviously, day 5 will be my day, so I'll be hyping the crap out of it. But if you're interested in a fun time, a good experience, community-driven initiatives, may I recommend the Advent of Cyber activity on TriHackMe? I'd love to share with you BSEC's... he'll be on YouTube, so you could definitely giddy up on that. All right, let me flip it. Let me ask you guys, anybody... any feedback or questions on the 24/7 Lo-Fi channel, the community itself, the all hands meeting, my Thursday guests? We've got some really great Thursday guests coming up in this year. We've got Mike Saunders from Red Siege, who's amazing. We've got Mike Prevett coming on next week from Return on Security. He's awesome. I love that guy. He's out in London. We've got who else do we have? We've got some major players. Bo Bullock from Black Hills Information Security is going to be coming on talking about Graph Runner. Here you guys go. If you want to bookmark this or subscribe or whatever you want to call it, like hit the sub. This is BSEC's channel. BSEC is going to be, he's a mod. Everybody knows DJ BSEC in chat. He's a mod. He'll be doing TriHackMe's Advent of Cyber every single day. I'm not subscribed. Let me subscribe. So just so you guys know, if you want, he'll be doing live streams. I'm going to join as often as I can, but it's very much like Simply Cyber. Inclusive community, all good all the time. Let me go ahead and drop that Lo-Fi channel. If you guys want, this is Simply Cyber Cafe. It's my other channel just for fun. Here's a link to the cafe. And if you don't know what the cafe is, think of Simply Cyber as a mullet, okay? A mullet. You guys know what mullets are? Mullets are kind of coming back. Party, business up front, party in the rear. Simply Cyber's up front, Simply Cyber Cafe's in the rear. It's all about chill, good times, and that's why I'm doing lo-fi music on it right now. But there'll be other things, playing games, having like, you know, silly talks and stuff. Mike Corvette, Billy DP, Mike Saunders. Are you talking about Mike Saunders from Red Siege? BSEC, what time are you going to be streaming typically? People are wanting to know. Yeah, here we go. This is what you need to know about Simply Cyber Cafe. Yeah, this is Simply Cyber right here. And you see this hot mullet? That's Simply Cyber Cafe. It's a little play on words, but we're just having fun, man. Simply Cyber Cafe is all about fun. Oh, hey, D read the Mirai confessions from earlier this month. Fascinating journey. Thank you, D. I haven't read it yet, but I thought it was going to be cool. Does anyone have the link to the Friday class? Yes, D. Crawford, I do. Where is it? Here it is. D. Crawford, here you go. I just dropped a link in chat to the Friday class. It's a free class. It's on threat hunting. It's 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. I'll be in the class. Josh Mason will be in the class. We'll be actively engaged in the Discord. It'll be a good time. If you want to come learn with us, jump on there. It's free. $0. Free 99. Cool. Emilio Garcia's enjoyed the music yesterday. Able to do it. Zalia loves the music. Thank you. All right. So BSEC is saying that his streams will be around 7 p.m. Eastern time. I assume. BSEC is in Central time, I think. Right? BSEC, what time zone are you in? Time zones matter. Base Case always yells at me because I forget to put Eastern time zone because I'm entitled, and I think everybody operates in Eastern time zone. Chris Young says, Simply Cyber is a wonderful place. Thank you for building the community. My pleasure. It's my dream. It's my job. I'm very happy to support the community. Josh Collins asks if I have an affiliate link for Haiku. I don't, but I should. I will get one for you, Josh Collins, and I'll get one. I don't know why I don't. I stream it every other Monday. So it's 7 p.m. Central. So for people who operate in reality, 8 p.m. Eastern time, every day, BSEC will be bringing the heat during the month of December, December 1st through 24th. 8 p.m. Eastern, 7 Central. Tyler Ramsby released an AOC rap video. That's awesome. I do not have a rap video in mind. I hope people like my stream. I didn't do anything crazy in my day 5 video for Try Hack Me. Thanks, Chris Young. Casually Joseph. Team Eastern Time Zone. Rex Cognitius. Cognitioso. Rex, with all due respect, I'm going to just say Rex. Saying we should replace GMT. All right, guys, it is time. We had an extended jaw jacking. I hope you had fun today. Pro tip, the Citadel semester is almost over. I've got semester tomorrow. And then on Tuesday, I technically have class. And then that's it for the semester. Gary Sturgiatis, my man. I love me some Gary Sturgiatis. All right, guys, be good. Love you, mean it. David Beard also met his wife and knew it instantly. She was the one. I can't explain it, guys. It's not like I was like on the prowl. I wasn't in the club, right? Like I was literally like nerding out at a keyboard writing Perl code. And literally I was like sideways and they're like, Jerry, this is Nadine. She just started. And I'm like, ooh! Right. And that was the end of that. I was done. Have a great day, everybody. Be well, be good to each other. I'll see you tomorrow at 8 a.m. Eastern time. Go out there and crush it. Get 1% better today, whatever it is, move it forward. Have a great one. Be well, and I'll see you tomorrow. Until next time, I'm Jerry, your chat. Stay secure. Everybody, I hope you enjoyed that content. Keep the cybersecurity train going by connecting with the other Simply Cyber community resources. We have the Discord server that's lively and always keeps the conversation going. You can connect with me directly on LinkedIn. And also every single weekday morning on the Simply Cyber channel, we're doing live daily cyber threat briefings, 8 a.m. Eastern time, as well as Thursday at 4:30 p.m. We're doing live stream interviews with industry experts, and we produce videos that we push out every Wednesday morning. I'm Jerry from Simply Cyber. I hope you enjoyed the content, and we'll see you in the next one.